Turn your Bibles to Psalm 13. Oh, there we go. Awesome. What did you do? Thank you. It is. Right before our very eyes. Psalm 13. Here we go. What happened Sunday night? Oh. Oh, is that what it was? Okay, now I think we're ready to proceed. We have entitled this entire series, Encouraged by God's Sovereign Reign, fitting into our yearly theme now, this year for encouragement. It's amazing how when we look at the book of Psalms, we can be encouraged because there's so much of life reflected in the Psalms. It's almost as if Psalms becomes this mirror at which you can kind of look into it and it bounces back to you the realities of life. There's probably some of your wisdom literature actually in the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes could be included. There's parts of the Old Testament that seem to speak more to the nitty-gritty of life than much of the rest of the Bible. It's pretty fascinating. And so that's one of the reasons that we're looking at Psalms the way we are. And tonight we're going to be looking at Psalm 13. Psalm 13... exhibits a threefold movement when the psalmist engages in prayer because he's in trouble. And there's a description of the trouble, and we're going to look at verses 1 and 2. Then there's the petition for help in verses 3 and 4. And then there is praise and confident trust in the Lord. Recently, I've come across a Romanian philosopher and agnostic named E.M. Cioran. And he's supposed to be sort of the father of nihilism, which basically says nothing has meaning and life is meaningless. So think about that. That's sort of what he proposed in his philosophical writings. Exactly. That was my immediate thought, which is good. At one point, though, listen to what he said about human pain and suffering, where it was his recognition that Christianity does have something to say, but he didn't want to develop what it had to say. But he says this, a cry, like if you're crying out because of pain, a cry means something only in a created universe. If there is no creator, what is the good of calling attention to yourself? That's the question he raised. I thought, that's fascinating with a philosophical agnostic recognizing that. Because certainly the psalmist believes in a creator who hears and responds to the human cry for help. He certainly does. So as we begin looking at this, I already put this up here, didn't I? Let's go to the first, and it's a description of the trouble. And if you have accessed one way or another Psalm 13, let me read it in its entirety as we get started. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. This prayer, as you notice, begins with a description of the trouble. And four times in this short little psalm, he's going to say, how long, O Lord? probably at one time or another, each of us have had life experiences that has forced us to cry out like that. How long, O Lord? And it may be a financial situation. It may be physical or emotional pain. Whatever the source, at one time or another, we may ourselves have been driven to asking the question, how long, O Lord? One of the things that we need to recognize is when you, at least, now I'm going to say this from the psalmist's perspective, when David writes this, he does not see this as being unfaithful toward God. He doesn't see this as lack of faith. In fact, we're going to get to that toward the end of chapter 13. David has the kind of relationship with God that he believes that in order for him to recognize that that relationship is authentic, it's okay for him to come to God and say, oh Lord, how long? Okay? Also, it's a cry of desperation because the sorrow and pain he's experienced apparently has not let up. There is nothing that is more dispiriting to the human experience and the human heart than pain, whatever the source. I mean, it can be relational pain, it can be emotional, it can be mental, it can be physical, I mean, you name it. But deep-seated pain that hurts, that doesn't let up, can be very dispiriting to the human heart. It's like the writer is asking, will you forget me forever? When suffering is relentless, it is part of the human experience to feel like God has forgotten us. The hiddenness of God and the silence of God is a significant theme in the study of the book of Psalms. And several writers in the book of Psalms recognize that. Where are you, O God? Well, one place David says, wake up from your sleep, pay attention. And I'm not sure any of us here tonight would feel quite comfortable in saying that in our prayer life. Maybe you have. I haven't yet. I think I would feel pretty uncomfortable. But David has that kind of relationship, and he believes it's his right in his relationship with God to be able to say that. Okay? Several times in this collection then of the 150 Psalms, the composers lament that it seems God is nowhere to be found. So let's start looking at some of these. I think this will be very important for us as we look at this. First, in Psalm chapter 6 and verse 3, we're going to be kind of going through some of the Psalms tonight with various aspects of this theme. My soul is in anguish. How long, O Lord, how long? Can you think of and identify in your own Christian life where that expression would be a good way of labeling what you have felt, that your soul has been in anguish? That's a strong way to express what's going on inside of a person, isn't it? Because when you think of anguish, you think of something that's so painful, deeply felt. Now, notice the context of this. In each one of these, there's a context. I always hate just quoting one verse. Notice back in chapter 6, verse 1, O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your wrath. Now, some commentators would recognize that it appears, we don't know, I wish we knew the actual setting here, but it appears that for some reason, David has felt that he's done something that God could rebuke him in his anger about, and that perhaps David even deserves discipline. But he says, be merciful to me, Lord, for I am faint. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are in agony. Again, a great expression about the pain you're going through. My soul is in anguish. How long, O Lord, how long? So in Psalm 6, and again, it's a short psalm, but you have this, it's a plea for God to pay attention to what he believes that he needs. And we're going to find out in a little bit when we move past the description of the trouble. The second movement is specific petitions to God. And notice the one in Psalm 6. The specific petition, turn, O Lord, and deliver me. Save me because of your unfailing love. And that expression, because of your unfailing love, and it's kind of funny because this comes up in chapter 6, but it's also in 13, is the third movement of the prayer. It's confident trust based on God. And it says something like this. I know the pain is relentless. The anguish is deep. My bones are in agony. Help! You know, this is as bad as it can get. And you're able to say that to God, and you tell God what it is you're really looking for and what you really want. But notice, and we're going to see this, even though David expects God to direct his attention to the specifics of his petition, David's rejoicing and his praise doesn't come because the prayer is answered. It's what's fascinating in Psalms. It comes because of his confident trust in who God is and the covenant relationship he has with God in anticipation of the answer. Now, the reason that is crucial is because I think a lot of people get stuck here, that they feel like they cannot praise God because their prayers haven't been answered. They've been in agony. They've had very specific requests that they've given to God, but because they didn't get the answer to those requests, guess what? They're not happy with God. And what's missing is that third movement here, and we're going to talk about it when we get there. It's so crucial. It recognizes who God is. And ultimately, I'm confident as I place all of this in God's hands. And that's the basis of our blessings. Not the fact that he's actually already. And think about this. I'm confident that prayer would be used by more people and God would get more praise if every time someone, you know, think about this, every time someone gave a request, specific request, and asked a petition of God, if every single time that prayer was specifically answered, boy, the world would be different, wouldn't it? You would have people clamoring to be Christians everywhere, I would think. I don't know, just the way the human mind works. But in the Psalms, this is different. Part of the journey is recognizing who God is as you place everything in his hands. And we'll continue. But I just noticed as we're reading through here, it's the same threefold movement here in Psalm 6.
Pray, it was so intense.
Oh, yeah.
Sweats was drops of blood.
Oh, yeah.
The agony was going through it.
This would be an interesting study, just because you brought that up, Johnny. Wouldn't it be neat to go through the whole Bible and be aware of all of the expressions and metaphors used to describe human pain and agony? See, now for Jesus in the garden, it was as if it were great drops of blood, the sweat. Picturing that agony must have really, really been something emotional, mental, anticipating the physical, all that he went through. And I think the Psalm, well, here's what's going to be interesting. Psalm 22 is going to provide us some more metaphors to help us think about some of the experience of the pain that Jesus went through at the cross. And so I think in the future, we have an entire night dedicated to Psalm 22 because Jesus is going to make some of those connections. And when you understand how the psalmist paints the pain of human experience in Psalm 22, it really gives you some good insights into the pain Jesus was going through. Okay, let's go to Psalm 35 and verse 17. I think the thing that surprised me the most for this lesson was how many times just in the book of Psalms that the psalmist kept asking, "How long, O Lord?" I mean, I hadn't really had any reason to pursue that line of thought, but because of tonight's lesson, I was just made aware of how many times it's there. Psalm 35, 17, let me read that verse and then we'll set it in context. O Lord, how long will you look on? Rescue my life from their ravages, my precious life from these lions. Now, were the lions physical? Probably not. David's really good at using metaphors. We're assuming that many of these psalms were written while he was king. There's some of them that seems like may not have been, but most of them looks like they were composed when he was in various situations in his leadership role. So for his precious life to be rescued from the ravages of lions, what was it? Nancy had something on the History Channel. Oh, it was the different kings and their reigns in the history of England, and it focused on Henry VIII. And I was just amazed at how bloodthirsty everybody was for position and power. It's like, whoa, when you become aware of that. And so it was no different in David's time. You've got people who are really after him. And on one occasion, one of the Psalms, he says that there was someone closer than a brother who betrayed him. And I wish that he'd gone into detail in that psalm, because your interest is really piqued. Wonder what happened on that occasion. And so in the Psalms, you have these wonderful words of trying to process betrayal. And every time I read that psalm, I think about Jesus being betrayed by Judas when I read that. Okay, so in Psalm 35, 17, look at a little bit earlier. Probably because he talks about ruthless witnesses that have come forward. They question me on things that I know nothing about. They repay me evil for good and leave my soul forlorn. I mean, he's really good at painting this picture, everybody against him. When I stumbled, this verse 15, they gathered in glee. Attackers gathered against me when I was unaware. They slandered me without ceasing. Like the ungodly, they maliciously mocked. They gnashed their teeth at me. O Lord, how long will you look on? Rescue my life from their ravages, my precious life from these lions. Okay, so there's his petition. It's pretty specific, isn't it? But notice what happens. He moves into, in this psalm too, he moves into another movement. I will give you thanks in the great assembly. Among throngs of people, I will praise you. Now notice the prayer's not been answered about the Lord rescuing him, but he moves immediately after the petitions into praising God in the assembly. And let not those gloat over me who are my enemies without cause. And then he keeps on going on about all of that. Vindicate me, and so on and so forth. But even in the midst of this lengthy one of Psalm 35, he still finds the opportunity be able to bless God in the great assembly and rejoice over who God is. Even though it looks like this was an occasion in his leadership role where he's got a bunch of people after him. And he's just like, how much more of this can I take? You know, so. Okay, the next one is Psalm 74. And this one's really interesting. Psalm 74. And what is it, verse 9, Psalm 74, 9. We're given no miraculous signs, no prophets are left, and none of us knows how long this will be. How long will the enemy mock you, O God? There is the indication this may have been a psalm that was composed during the exile. Think about how painful that must have been for Israel as a nation. On one occasion, the psalmist says that here we are in Babylon, the foreigners come to us. It's kind of funny, they're foreigners in a foreign land, but they say the foreigners come to us. They ask us to sing the songs of Israel on our harps. And he goes, we were so heartbroken, we couldn't. We just hung our harps on the willow tree and just sat under the tree and cried. I mean, boy, you talk about a heart-wrenching sort of national kind of despair. That's what Israel was experiencing on that occasion. And it looks like this may have been also composed during the exile. We're given no signs from God. No prophets are left. And none of us knows how long this will be. God, how long? And then Psalm 79, verse 5. Then we'll have to move on. How long, O Lord, will you be angry forever? How long will your jealousy burn like fire? Pour out your wrath on the nations that do not acknowledge you, on the kingdoms that do not call on your name. For they've devoured Jacob and destroyed his homeland. Do not hold against us the sins of the fathers. May your mercy come quickly to meet us, for we're in desperate need. How long, O Lord, will you be angry forever? And it sounds like that the psalmist feels that God is not only angry at the nations who don't recognize his reign, he may also be sort of angry at them for the sins of the fathers. And he's like, oh, Lord, you know, yeah, don't do that to us. How long will you be angry? Help us, O God, our Savior, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and forgive our sins for your name's sake. It's interesting, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, in the New Testament, when it teaches forgiveness, forgiveness is never dangled before humanity like a carrot on a string by God. When people come to God confessing, repenting, asking for God's forgiveness, in every single situation that Scripture, in different ways that Scripture can find to say it, God immediately forgives, which is an amazing thing on God's part, isn't it? Is it always that easy for us as human beings just to, with the snap of the finger, forgive somebody? How many times you've, well, maybe we haven't said it, you haven't said it, but how many times have you heard somebody else say, I'll forgive you, but I'm not going to forget. Well, is that really forgiving? Well, I would say that sometimes it is hard to forget. And it may be that a significant difference between God and ourselves, God says when he forgives, he removes it from his memory as far as the east is from the west. Now, if that's true, that's something we human beings have a hard time doing. I think forgiveness at least has to take the sting out of the memory. That sometimes memories are so painful they leave scars, kind of like when you get hurt physically. But forgiveness allows the scars not to have the pain anymore. Because sometimes things will come up where you remember. And the question is, what are you going to do when it comes back up in your mind? Yeah, Bill.
I think the answer to that is parable about the man who had the evil spirit and he was cast out.
Oh, yeah.
And he didn't fill it with the good stuff, and the evil spirit came back and brought seven more with him.
Yeah.
I think what Jesus was trying to teach us there is that we have to purge our minds of these evil and bad and disfiguring thoughts that we have, either about ourselves or about others, and then, and there has to be an effort that is made.
Yeah, that's a good thought, because if you think about forgiveness, if you do want to replace, you know, bad feelings of holding something against someone, there has to be an intention not to do that. And when you forgive someone, you're inviting God into that process, and it's very intentional. And think of the work that it takes to replace bad thoughts with the good ones. That's an intentional hard work. But sometimes that's the only thing the only option you have left open in order to honor God. Let's move on just for, because of our time's moving quickly. Notice also that in Psalm 13, in this particular psalm, it has a second movement. And this second movement is a prayer for help, and it's tied to the trouble that the writer is experiencing. In Psalm 13, he says, "Consider and answer me." And it would seem that the Psalms teach us that in prayer, it's okay to grab God's attention and ask for specific answers. That may seem a little bold, but the writer of Psalm 13 didn't think so. At least he was willing to do it. He's desperately seeking God's answers to his prayers, because in this chapter, he doesn't want to die a meaningless death where his enemies rejoice and believe they have ruined his reputation. I mean, it's interesting what sort of motivates this prayer. But this particular psalm was prayed in the belief that God really does care about him. And God cares about what's happening to David. And David believes that God will rise up and vindicate him in the face of his enemies. In Psalm 6 and verse 4, he says, "Turn, Lord, and deliver me. Save me because of your unfailing love." This is the specific petition. Turn and deliver me. Now, I think, wow, I should have checked on this. I'm going to go out on the limb here. I think this word turn in the Hebrew is the same root word that is used, that the prophets say to Israel, turn back to the Lord. It's the idea of turning. And when it's used for human beings, it's the idea of sort of repentance, turning of mind. But isn't it interesting that David will use this word turn? Lord, turn. It's like, turn your head around, pay attention, deliver me. Yeah, Joe? Yeah, okay, good. Yeah, it's the same. I hadn't had time to look it up. I was just taking a stab at it. I've noticed through the years you have to be careful of things that you say. And I've been guilty of this. You know, you're preparing a lesson, or you got a sermon, you got a point you're going to make, and you go, yeah, this is what Scripture says. And then when you go back and you do your checking, you're like, oh man, I can't make that point. That's not what that says. So, okay, I'm going to throw that one out the window. But isn't it fascinating that the psalmist says, Lord, you turn. Turn back. Look at me. Pay attention and deliver me. So there's the specific petition in that particular psalm. Psalm 35. He says, Lord, you have seen this, and do not be silent. Let me go back to Psalm 35 a minute, because I want to make the correct comment on what he... Psalm 35, 22. Rise to my defense. Vindicate me in your righteousness. You've seen this. Oh, it's about all of his enemies who are gloating over him. They maliciously wink the eye like, aha, you got what's coming. They don't speak peaceably. They devise false accusations. They gape at me and say, aha, aha, with our own eyes, we've seen it. You know, his end, we've seen him come to an end. And then he says, oh, Lord, you've seen this. You see how I've been treated. You see what these people do. Do not be silent. Do not be far from me, Lord. Awake, wake up, rise to my defense.
Contend for me, my God and my Lord. Vindicate me in your righteousness, Lord my God, and do not let them gloat over me. So here's all these petitions all of at once. Boom, boom, boom. He keeps asking God, you've seen this, Lord. Wake up. I want you to do something. So this is within the tradition of the Psalms of the specific petitions that he is willing to pray. Look at Psalm 74. Rise up, O God, and defend your cause. Remember how fools mock you all day long. Do not ignore the clamor of your adversaries, the uproar of your enemies, which rises continually. So rise up, O God, defend your cause. Don't ignore what they're doing. So he has these specific petitions, asking God to pay attention, rise up, get busy, get to work. You know, it's like he's really trying to say something to God to get God involved. You know, this is pretty strong language, isn't it? Now, it moves then in the third section, this third movement. He praises God with confident trust. Turn back to Psalm 13. What is so fascinating, the reason I'm using Psalm 13 as a model, so many times in the Psalms, you see this movement. And sometimes it's not the whole psalm. It may be embedded within a particular psalm. But you've got the expression, very vivid, of personal pain, very vivid of the anguish and the agony that he's going through, and then very specific petitions to God based on that experience. Not something general. I'll give you an example. Several years ago, and I think I've told this story to a few of you, this was, I was a young preacher, so I didn't know how to handle this. Someone chose on Sunday morning assembly on Easter, on a final public prayer, to challenge my ministry. And started off with, in the prayer, "Dear Lord, we cannot say that we've heard a gospel sermon this morning." I mean, I was, you know them. I was so shocked. I looked over at Nancy. I said, "Did I hear what I just heard?" I didn't even tell her what I heard. She just went, "Yeah." So there was a big meeting in the afternoon with the elders, and he finally agreed that he would apologize to the congregation for that prayer. Well, when he got up to apologize, it was on Sunday night. And he was leading communion Sunday night. We got up and he said, "If I have done anything wrong to offend anyone, I'm sorry." And he sat down. I went home. I was fit to be tied. Nancy goes, no, don't worry about it. That's his confession. Let it be. But see, it wasn't specific. And the guy that did it, he knew it wasn't specific. If I've done anything to hurt anybody, I'm sorry. Really? So that, you know, that was early.
What did he think was missing?
What's that?
What did he think was missing in the sermon?
Oh, all kinds of things. Well, it was on Easter Sunday. And believe it or not, what I think he wanted was for me to preach a sermon denouncing everybody else practicing Easter. But in order not to do that, I had planned, I was preaching a series of lessons through Daniel. So I, at one level, I said, "Yeah, you're right. I didn't preach a gospel sermon. I preached out of Daniel." Well, that made it worse. So anyway, welcome to church life at an early time of my ministry. But Bill, you...
I had a lady one time told Judy, she says, you know, it's not a good sermon unless he preaches about baptism.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, isn't it funny? But you know, and as a sidelight, isn't it funny the criteria that people have for a good sermon? We all have our own criteria where we think we do or not. But that, yeah, that was a whole... So this whole thing of specific request, specific confession. I think I mentioned this a couple lessons back. There's a wonderful book that was written by Dietrich Bonhoeffer called Spiritual Care. And it was written while he was in prison. In the beginning of the book, he has a wonderful insight that he says the first step of moving away from sin is that you have to specifically identify it. He was worried that the church of his day had gotten so far away from naming sin specifically that he didn't see that the church was helping very much in a lot of the problems of the culture of his day and time, that the church, now there were a few, there were probably more churches he was aware of, but he became part of what was called the German Confessing Lutheran Church. And that church recognized that the rest of the expression of the church and the national churches of Germany, they were all being sucked right in with everything that Hitler wanted. And so Bonhoeffer says, in order for sin to be dealt with, you have to start with naming the specific sin. And I would say that same principle is true when you're dealing with problems in your prayer life. You know, you don't go to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, if I've had any trouble this past week, or if anything went bad today, if you can find it in your heart, maybe do something good. That's not the kind of prayer David knows. I mean, it is specific, and he is asking the Lord to get with it, okay? Now, here's why. This is the neat part of it. It's because this is where prayer moves toward faith in God. It's this third movement. We move from the description of the trouble to specific petition and then to praising God with confident trust. David's trust is in God's steadfast love. And the NIV says steadfast love everywhere it occurs. I know that the New American Standard Bible says loving kindness. I think the King James Version and much of the Tyndale tradition does too, says loving kindness. It's not the best word. The idea of love is involved, but the best translation for the Hebrew chesed, the words chesed, is covenant faithfulness. And it's, I think there may be one or two English translations, they're not as popular, but they go that route, covenant faithfulness. Is it just faithfulness? Okay, that's getting closer.
I trust in your faithfulness.
Uh-huh, that's getting closer because the idea is covenant faithfulness. This expression is precisely why David can approach God with such confident trust. He knows that God will always be there and God will always be faithful no matter what. He knows God cares. He knows God hears. God will always be there to walk beside us in our suffering. Sometimes, even though David's confident, he learned this, sometimes God takes away our suffering, sometimes he doesn't. But he'll always be there. And it's that covenant faithfulness of God's presence, he'll always be there, that makes the world a difference. See, if we get a false theology that says he'll always answer our prayer to remove the suffering, we're headed for a lot of trouble. We're headed for a lot of trouble if that's our belief. Okay, in the time that we have, let's look at a few of these. In Psalm 17, look at verse 7, and again, I sort of appropriated the New American Standard Version, but in each case, it just says loving kindness. Psalm 17, 7. Show the wonder of your great love. Is that right? That's not the one I was wanting.
This one says, accomplish awesome faithful deeds.
Okay. And that's in verse 7? Show the, okay, yeah, the wonder of your great love. See, the great love there with the NIV is covenant faithfulness. The great deed, and see, I like that. The great deeds of your covenant faithfulness. Here's what this actually is all about. And all of us can really tap into this. I want you to think about how long you have lived the Christian life. Think of all the ways now that's in the backlog of your files, whether it's in the file of your mind or the file of your heart the file of your Christian experiences, think of all of the great deeds that God has performed on your behalf because of His covenant faithfulness. And as the years go by, you have more and more, perhaps clarity of vision on that than you would have years ago. And that's the basis of this trust. We trust God because we have been able to trust Him. He is faithful in His covenant relationship. He won't change. If anybody changes, it's me, it's not God. Okay, and then Psalm 31, 7. And see, I'm reading from the NIV, and if you didn't have a Hebrew interlinear, you wouldn't know this. I'll be glad and rejoice in your love. Well, rejoice in your covenant faithfulness. For you saw my affliction and knew the anguish of my soul. It goes right back to what we've been studying tonight. Notice, he's glad and he's going to rejoice in God's faithfulness because God saw that. See, our, I want to use the word difficult. Our difficulties of life do not go unnoticed by God. And it would seem to me that one of the greatest blessings that a Christian has that a non-Christian either is not aware of or can't appreciate is that difficulties of life, God the Father, who's in a loving covenant relationship with us, difficulties of life do not go by unnoticed. Wow, okay. And I would say that's a stake you need to put in the ground and hang on to. What that means is He will hear our prayer. He will be there present with us. He may answer and remove the suffering. He may not. I don't know why He doesn't sometimes. We do, and that is a lesson. We do have a few scriptures that talk about why some prayers aren't answered. It is pretty clear. If I ask with the wrong motive, or if my life is so in rebellion against God that my heart's not in it, I mean, there's a lot of interesting variations of unanswered prayer. But if I'm in a covenant relationship with God, and I'm one of His children, and I'm walking faithfully, led by His Spirit, all the wonderful things you can say about a Christian life, and I have all these problems, they're not going to go unnoticed by God. And I can rely on God when I need to, when things get too hot and heavy. What's that? Psalm 31. Oh, yeah. This is a good one, isn't it? Psalm 31. Praise be to the Lord, for He showed His wonderful love to me when I was in a besieged city. Now, I'm assuming this is literal. This may be literal. Here he is, a king, and things are going bad, and he and his men are surrounded. They're in a besieged city. In my alarm, I said, I'm cut off from your sight, O Lord. Yet you heard my cry for mercy when I called to you for help. Love the Lord, all His saints. Well, if the Lord got him out of that situation, I could see why he would say, love the Lord, all you saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but the proud He pays back in full. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. I love verse 24. There's been many times in my life I've come back to 24 here. Be strong and take heart, all you who hope in the Lord. Man, that's a beautiful expression of faithful trust, isn't it? And I think that's part of how we need to face life. Knowing that life is full of difficulties. This Psalm 13 is an amazing psalm. It's one of the shorter ones that contains this threefold movement. That is very important. And remember we talked about thinking about the psalms being not only the stuff of some of our prayers, but also providing some insights about the model for prayer. And this is a great one that I think is very important for us. to be able to describe in detail in our prayer to God what we believe the trouble is, to invite God into that process, that God do something. And then you praise God for who he is because of the covenant relationship we've got with him. And you leave it in his hands.
You talk about a great life of faith.
That's it.
You're confidently trusting in God.
It's up to him. That's an amazing approach to your life and prayer life because it does give you a lot of inner peace.
Because I tell you, if you go other directions,
you don't get a whole lot of peace.
I've experienced that route.
I've had a lot of other people get out. Of going the wrong direction, wrong thinking here.
Any comments or questions as we close out tonight?
Obviously, we couldn't go through all the scriptures I had, but
this at least gives you an insight into the psalmist here
and providing us with this wonderful model of prayer.
Any comments or questions before I close with prayer? Thank you, guys, for coming down front. I know the people looking on the live stream.
Appreciate it.
Let's end with prayer.
Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight. We are so grateful for the songs that have been written left to us. Particularly this psalm, Psalm 13. It provides for us a way to think about and utilize a model of prayer that describes to you is authentic and honest with the trouble we're in. And also ask you to directly intervene and do some things. And all of this is based on our covenant relationship with you and your covenant faithfulness. And we confidently place our trust in you, knowing that you will respond in a way that will further your will and your desires on the face of the earth. Lord, thank you for being our King. We're encouraged by your sovereign reign. And be with us as we depart this place tonight, that as we think about our prayer life, we can be emboldened in it, as was the psalmist. We thank you for all of this. It's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Thank you all for being here tonight. Appreciate it.